Hello, welcome back to Learn Economia. In this video, we are going to look into an important topic, which is Pareto optimality. The welfare of a society depends in the broadest sense upon satisfaction levels of all its consumers. But almost every change in the economic state of society will have favorable effects on some members and unfavorable effects on some others. Evaluation of such a social change is impossible unless the economist is ready to go to interpersonal comparison of utility under some value judgment, which he may not be willing to do. Rather, he will be willing to evaluate such changes where at least one person has been better off and no one else worse off. The Italian economist Wilfredo Pareto, he said that if a change in the economic state makes at least one individual better off without making anyone worse off, then the change for the betterment of social welfare. So he says that this change is something which is desirable. In that case, we say that the initial state was Pareto non-optimal. From Pareto non-optimal, after reallocation, Pareto optimality is attained. On the other hand, if a change makes no one better off and at least one person worse off, implying that the change will make the society worse off, then from the point of view of welfare, the initial economic state is Pareto optimal. I mean, the initial allocation was Pareto optimal. From this Pareto optimal allocation, a reallocation was made, and in the reallocation, Pareto non-optimality is attained. So the initial one, the first allocation was Pareto optimal. Okay. What are the conditions of Pareto optimality? There have been three main conditions of Pareto optimality, which deals with exchange, production, consumption, economy, etc. Every aspect of the economy is covered in these three conditions. First of all, we have the efficiency in exchange. The first condition of Pareto optimality relates to the efficiency of exchange. The required condition is that the marginal rate of substitution between any two products must be the same for every individual who consumes both. Okay, so we have the two consumers, two goods, and we look into the marginal rate of substitution between the two commodities in the case of both the individuals. Okay, the marginal rate of substitution between the two consumer goods must be equal to the ratio of its prices. Since under perfect competition, every consumer aims at maximizing his utility, he will equate his marginal rate of substitution for two goods, let's name it X and Y, to their prices Px by Py. Okay, that is the price ratio. So we are going to equate the marginal rate of substitution for two goods to their prices or to their price ratio. Suppose that there are two consumers A and B who buy two goods X and Y, and each faces a price ratio Px by Py. Thus, A will choose X and Y such that his AMRS XY is equal to Px by Py. Okay. Now, similarly, in the case of B, he will choose X and Y such that his MRS XY would be equal to Px by Py. Here there's a small mistake in the case of A. It is not Xx by XY, it is Px by Py. Okay. Therefore, the condition for efficiency in exchange is equal to MRS XY of A is equal to MRS XY of B, which is equal to Px by Py. Okay. In the box diagram, here we can understand the optimal condition of exchange. Take two individuals, A and B, who possess two goods X and Y in the fixed quantities respectively. OA is the origin for consumer A and OB is the origin for consumer B. So, in order to understand it more clearly, I mean, with respect to the case of consumer B, you can turn the diagram upside down. Okay. Especially with respect to consumer B, if you are confused about consumer B, just turn the diagram upside down and then look into the diagram. Then you will be getting a better understand. Vertical sides of the two axes OA and OB represent good Y, and the horizontal axis in the case of both consumer A as well as consumer B, this shows good X. The indifference map of A is represented by A, the curves A1, A2, A3, etc. And in the case of B's map, this is represented by B1, B2, B3, etc. So these are the indifference curves for consumer A as well as consumer B. Any point within this box represents the possible distribution of the two goods between the two consumers. Take the point E where the two indifference curves A1 as well as B1 intersect. At this point, A possesses OA YA units of Y and OA XA unit of X. B receives OB YB of Y and OB XB of X. At point D, the marginal rate of substitution between the two goods is equal to the price ratio. And here, the two curves do not have the same slope. Okay, so E is not a point of optimum exchange of two goods X and Y between the two consumers A and B. Let's try to find out the point where one individual becomes better off without making the other one worse. Suppose A would like to have more of X and B would like to have more of Y. Each will be better off without making the curve worse off if he moves to a higher indifference curve. Let them move from point E to point R. At R, A gets more of X by sacrificing some Y and B gets more of Y by sacrificing some amount of X. There is no improvement in B's position because he is on the same indifference curve B1, and in the case of A, but we can see that A is much better off at R, having moved to a higher indifference curve from A1 to A3. If, however, A and B move from E to P, A is as well as before, for he remains on the same indifference curve A1, B becomes much better off having moved from B1 to B3. It is only when they move from E to Q that both are on a higher indifference curve. P, Q, R are the three conceivable points of exchange. The contour curve CC is the locus of this point of tangency, which shows that the various position of exchange that equalize the marginal rates of substitution of X and Y. At any point on CC curve, therefore, satisfies this optimum condition of exchange, but a movement along the contour curve in either direction always tends to make one individual better off at the expense of the other person. Thus, each point on the contour curve represents optimal social welfare in the Pareto sense. Having discussed efficiency in exchange, the second criteria is efficiency in production. There are three allocation rules for demonstrating efficiency in production and a perfect competition. Rule 1 relates to optimum allocation of factors, the factors which are used for the production of the commodity. So here we look into the labor as well as capital. These are the two main factors that we take into consideration here. It requires that the marginal rate of technical substitution between two factors must be same for the two firms using these factors to produce the same product. Suppose there are two firms A and B and two factors, labor and capital, to produce one product. Okay. Given the price of two factors, the labor as well as capital, a firm is in equilibrium under perfect competition when the slope of an isocon equals to the slope of isocost line. These are some things which we already know. The slope of an isocon is the MRTS of labor and capital, and the slope of isocost line is the ratio of the price of labor as well as capital. Thus, the condition of equilibrium for A is MRTS LK of A is equal to PL by PK, and that of B is MRTS LK of B is equal to PL divided by PK. It's not PL PK, it's PL divided by PK. Therefore, rule 1 for efficiency in production is MRTS LK of A is equal to MRTS LK of B is equal to PL by PK. The rule 2 states that the marginal rate of transformation between any factor and any product must be the same for any pair of firms using the factor as well as producing the product. It means that the margin of productivity of any factor in producing a particular product must be same for all the firms. A firm and a perfect combination will employ a factor of production up to the point at which its marginal value product equals its price. That is, its MVP or its VMP, sorry, not MVP, its VMP is equal to its price. MVP is the marginal physical product of labor in the production of good X in firm A. Then its VMP is the marginal physical productivity multiplied by its price. That is, VMP is equal to MVP into L. Okay, PX is the price of labor. In the case of PX, we can see that the price of labor, which is PL, in the firm A is equal to PL, is equal to A into MBPL of X. Okay, since we are taking into consideration the commodity X. Similarly, in firm B, the price of labor is PL, which is equal to MBPL of commodity X with respect to labor into P. Since the price of the product and the price of labor are the same in both the firms, each firm will equate its marginal physical productivity to its price ratios. Thus, in equilibrium, each firm has the same marginal physical productivity of labor in producing the product X. Rule 3 for efficiency in production requires that the marginal rate of transformation between any two products must be same for two firms that produce the both. This condition requires that if there are two firms A and B, both produce two products X and Y, where the marginal rate of transformation between the two commodities or between the two factors, this would be equal. A profit maximizing firm under perfect competition will be in equilibrium when the ISO revenue line is tangent to its transformation curve. So these are the things which we are going to discuss in the coming slides. Okay, so we can use a figure to explain this. Here in the early case, I mean with respect to the efficiency in exchange, we can use a figure which is similar to the figure which we have already discussed in with respect to the exchange case, efficiency exchange case. But the only difference is that instead of consumers, you are giving the factors. Instead of commodities, you have firms and all. So there are certain differences. Instead of consumers, you have to look into the case of factors. All else are the same. Okay. Sorry, instead of commodities, you are looking into the case of factors. That's it. Okay. Now, coming to the third point, which is the efficiency of exchange as well as production. Here, we have to look into the transformation curve. Pareto optimality in the perfect competition also requires a marginal rate of substitution between the two products on the P equal to the marginal rate of transformation between them. It means simultaneous efficiency in consumption as well as production. So, you are mixing both the consumption as well as production to have an overall picture of the economy. Since the price ratios of the two products to consumers and firms are the same under perfect competition, the MRs of all individuals will be identical with MRT of all the firms. Consequently, the products, two products will be produced and exchanged efficiently. Symbolically, MRs XY is equal to PX by PY, MRT XY is equal to PX by PY, and therefore we can see that MRs XY is equal to MRT XY. Figure here illustrates overall Pareto optimality in consumption as well as production. PP is the transformation curve for the commodity, it is the economy. Here we can see that it is a production possibility frontier for the two goods X and Y. Any point in PP curve shows a marginal rate of transformation between the X and Y reflects the relative opportunity cost of producing X and Y, which is equal to MCX by MCY. Curves I1 and I2 are the indifference curves which represent the consumer tastes for two commodities. The slope of indifference curve at a point, at any point here, shows a marginal rate of substitution between X and Y, and Pareto optimality is attained at a point which is represented at E, where the slope of the transformation curve and the indifference curve are equal. This equality in slopes is shown by the price line, which indicate that MRxy is equal to MRtxy is equal to Px by Py, or you can say that MuX by MuY is equal to McX by McY is equal to Px by Py. Okay. Given the production possibility from your PP1, there is no other indifference curve which satisfies Pareto efficiency. Point A is the efficient production because it is below PP1 curve. And point B is on the production possibility from you, but it is on the lower indifference curve, where the consumer satisfaction is not maximized. Therefore, the Pareto optimality exists only at point E, where there is some kind of efficiency in both consumption as well as production when the society consumes and produces OX1 of good X and OY1 of good Y. That's a condition necessary for attainment of Pareto optimality related to the efficiency in consumption, efficiency in production, and efficiency in consumption as well as production simultaneously. So these are the these conditions of Pareto optimalities are attained when the second order conditions are satisfied for each consumer as well as producer. No consumer is satiated and there are no external effects either in consumption or production, and there are no indivisibilities as well as there are no imperfections in factor as well as product markets. So that's all with respect to Pareto optimality. I hope you are clear. If you are not clear, what I'll be doing is that I'll be doing a separate video without figure, without diagrammatic explanation to make you understand the logic of the topic. I mean, I just want to make you clear about the essence of the topic. Just go through that video first and then come back to this video or it's your convenience. If you want to look in, if you're clear with the essence of the topic, then you can go through the figure. The only thing is that it is written incorrectly in certain parts. It's written incorrectly, especially with respect to notations and all. But I have told you correctly. So just listen to my words and rather than the one which is written here. With respect to notations, wherever it is wrong, I have told you the correct thing. So please follow that, the correct one, please follow that. And please like, share, subscribe to this channel for more videos. And I welcome you to my Telegram group and Telegram channel to discuss your doubts, to clarify your doubts. And so as I have told you, I'll be doing a separate video which will be discussing the essence of the Pareto optimality concept. That will be a short video. If you are not clear about a topic, then it's better for you to go through that video first and then come back to this video. Anyway, the next video will be on that because I want to make you clear about the topic. It's a very important topic. That's it. Okay, thank you for watching.